I'd like to start by thanking Ramadhavji, Shaurya Dovalji, and all their colleagues at India Foundation for putting on yet another stupendous event, which has become the must go to for thinkers around the country every year. In coming to this topic of rethinking governance and public institutions, I want to begin by commenting on the theme, which is turning to our roots and rising to heights. Now, I think this is relevant for us because if we look at undivided India, and in the present day context, we look to our neighbors on the west and the east, you see this dichotomy. And I think that sets the stage for us to think about our path in governance. To the west, in Pakistan, you have a modern civilization which denies where it came from, which thinks that it is somehow descended from the Arabs when it is not. And so you have this cognitive dissonance of everything in their structure, whether you take their constitution, whether you take the way they run their country, being in conflict with natural realities of where the people came from and how they think and how they work. If you look to our east, you see another part of undivided India, which has taken a somewhat different approach, where it recognizes its ethnic origins, it recognizes its linguistic origins, it takes equal pride in the national anthem having been written by Rabindranath Tagore, who also wrote our national anthem. And so these are two contradictory approaches to looking at your roots and setting the stage for rising in today's context. Now, we in India inherited a governance structure that we did not change. Unlike the Americans when they became independent, unlike China, which overcame colonial rule, who changed their governance structures very drastically, we chose to continue with the governance structures. So our parliament had been already put into place about 3 decades before independence, but it was a gesture by the Raj of yielding some ground to the nationalist movement, but not in full measure. So our parliament had many shortcomings, and I have written extensively about that. There isn't time to go into how our parliament was not delegated authority. I mean, we, for instance, continue to be the only parliament in the world where members of parliament do not have office, do not have staff, because they were not intended to be empowered. You go to any other national legislature in the world, this is a basic requirement of any legislature, that members have staff and office to prepare and represent their constituencies. But there are many others. One example is, we continued with the 19th century British convention that the upper house, which in Britain was not elected, could veto any decision by the House of Commons. We still have that. Rajya Sabha continues to veto, or has the ability to veto, Lok Sabha passages of law. But UK itself has moved on. In changes in 1911 and 1949, the UK introduced changes that the upper house can only act as a brake. So as of today, the UK's upper house can only slow down legislation by 1 year passed by the House of Commons to calm down passions, to rethink and take a reasonable decision rather than take decisions in haste or in emotion. But our governance structures are rooted in 19th century European context and have taken nothing from not much from our past, let alone learn from what these other colonial countries have moved on to, that we need to move on to. When we talk about CAA, which has been very debated just now, we were talking about the rights of the persecuted and the persecutors. I've often cited an example. We have our own long tradition of tolerance, and often the Parsis being given refuge in India is spoken about. Now, when the Parsis were given refuge in India because they were escaping persecution, we in India did not ask them, how can we give you refuge here unless we also give refuge and citizenship to your persecutors? think that in the context of how we can learn from our own history, and also in modern history, we look at how other nations have similar laws, such as CAA. The US has it, other democracies have it, to give shelter to persecuted minorities from other countries. Now, when we talk about governance in India, because of that rootedness in 19th century European structures, which are outdated both in Europe and in India, we have great shortcomings of governance. So over the last many decades, India first was written off as something that cannot exist as a democracy. Fortunately, we have proved the world wrong. But till date, we continue to get told that, yes, you've done all right on democracy, but your governance has shortcomings. And I think there is some point there. Now, a lot has happened in recent years. In the last 5 years, the foundations of that earlier edifice, which did not bother about governance, is getting shaken up. Now, I don't have the time to talk at great length, but one of my favorites of this shaking of the edifice is the Aadhaar project. Now, remember how much it was objected to just a few years ago by the same set of people who are today objecting to CAA and other things. If some of you have heard the Prime Minister, the statistics are quite stunning. Aadhaar has been applied to only a handful of governance programs till date. And just by application of a handful to a handful of government programs, 80 million fake beneficiaries have been weeded out. 80 million! And savings of 1,25,000 crores per annum already are accruing to India as of today. Now, this came as no surprise to me, because as an MP, when I conducted quarterly review meetings in the constituency, every single government school that I ever audited, I found up to 40% fake students. 40% fake students in every government school. That's how corruption happens. You bill midday meals for non-existent students. You bill uniforms, desks, chairs, books for non-existent students. So bringing about these dramatic changes in governance has this pushback, because many vested interests are getting rattled and shaken out of their comfortable perches. Since I don't have much time, instead of citing many examples, I'll cite maybe one more example to talk about how governance can change. So one of the aspects of governance that we've been talking about is the independence of our central bank, the Reserve Bank. Now, this has been an article of faith in many modern democracies for many decades, but it's not necessarily a settled issue. The economist Joseph Stiglitz, for instance, has written that central banks that have more independence do not necessarily perform better, and he has given a lot of statistics. In our own case, we have had many widely celebrated people heading the central bank, heading our Reserve Bank of India, who are considered to be competent. But part of the economic difficulties we have faced in recent years is that while the Reserve Bank has a mandate to manage inflation, and the way you manage inflation as far as the Reserve Bank is concerned is to have high interest rates, for quarter after quarter after quarter after quarter for many years during the first Modi government, inflation remained low, but the Reserve Bank refused to reduce its interest rates. This was a point of conflict from our late finance minister Arun Jaitley ji, who kept pointing this out. Now, if you have such blatantly irrational policies emanating from an institution that apparently has some of the most competent people running it, then you have to question whether our governance objectives are being made or whether we need to make dramatic changes. Now, I don't intend to be at the receiving end of Shakti ji's Shakti. With 12 seconds left, I'm going to say that there are many other such instances where we need to rethink. We need to go back to our roots, but we also need to apply modern tenets of what is right for India and find the right balance. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Thank you.